Hey folks, this is Kalani. Patch 10.2 is just around the corner, and it'll be introducing a whole bunch of new content, including a brand new season and a whole new raid. But with so many updates, it is hard to keep up with everything, and some changes will definitely go under the radar. But fear not, we've put together a list of lesser known changes that you might not know about, but will end up being quite impactful as we all head into the Emerald Dream. So we're going to go through 19 small but amazing changes that you really need to know about. Now before we jump in, be sure to hit up that like button and subscribe so you never miss another video. To start with, there is an amazing quality of life change coming for the talent system and how it reacts when you're swapping talents around. So before 10.2, when you wanted to change a talent that would break a connection to a talent or take you below the required talent spent for a breakpoint, it would just vacate any talent points that weren't valid anymore, which made it pretty annoying when you were wanting to swap around just one or two talents towards the top of your tree. That will be completely different in 10.2. Now you can just refund any talent you want, and if you break a connection or you no longer meet the breakpoint, any non-valid talent selections just turn red. They stay in their place, so you don't have to go back in and put everything back. You just need to reconnect the talent and make sure it is now a valid talent tree. This is going to be so much better for making small changes in your talent trees, especially if the talent points that you want to swap around are higher up in the talent tree. You would literally just need to swap those two talents now instead of redoing your entire tree. So that's a great quality of life change that I need everyone to know about. The Great Vault is also going to have a couple of changes in this patch that you'll want to know about. To start with, we're going to need fewer raid boss kills to fill up that raid reward row. We're down to 2 kills, 4 kills, and 7 kills for the first, second, and third reward respectively. So whether you're trying to fill it up to maximize your chances of a tier piece reward early in the season, trying to get some shiny new gear, or just filling up the row to maximize your token reward, it's going to be faster and easier to fill up the weekly vault on that raid row specifically. Another huge change for the Great Vault specifically is that the dungeon reward row is being changed from Mythic Dungeons to simply just Dungeons. So while you can still fill it up by running Mythic plus Dungeons, you can now also get credit for Heroic Dungeons, Mythic Zero Dungeons, and even Time Walking Dungeons. The rewards will be on par with what you would expect from the lower tiers of Dungeons, but this will allow everyone to get a reward out of their weekly vault without having to do higher end group content. You can just do queueable group content instead, which is much easier and way more accessible. Great vault rewards for everyone! The new patch also introduces a whole bunch of changes to the gear upgrade system, including a revamp for the crest and fragment currencies. To start with, we'll be collecting all new crests in the new season, dreaming crests of Whelpling, Drake, Worm, and Aspect varieties, so our season 2 crests will be more or less worthless in this new patch. We'll have to farm everything all over again. The good news though is that the fragments have actually been removed entirely, so we won't be collecting fragments and combining them into crests, we'll just straight up be collecting crests instead. The crests follow the value of fragments though, so it's kind of like we're actually only collecting fragments, but now they're called crests. Which could be a bit confusing at first, but I'm sure it all makes sense when we finally get to play around with it. The best part of this change though is that the new crests will not take up any bag space, they will instead be in the currency tab, so we'll be able to reclaim all of that precious bag space back. Perhaps one of the most important changes for the upgrade system in this patch is that we will finally be allowed to upgrade our crests to the next rank. So you can take your Drake crests and upgrade them to Worm crests to let you continue your gear upgrading adventures without having to actually go out there and farm Worm crests by yourself. The only major requirement for these upgrades is that you need to have reached an item level where you can no longer benefit from the lower tier of crests. So you'll need a piece of gear in every slot with an item level at the breakpoint where Drake crests are no longer used. So when you can no longer use Drake crests to upgrade any of your gear slots, you'll be allowed to upgrade any future Drake crests into Worm crests. This will also allow everyone to eventually work their way up to Aspect crests, no matter what type of content you take part in. Now this will probably only be for Season 3 crests, so don't worry about holding onto your Season 2 crests, they're mostly just going to be vendor trash when the big season reset comes through. Another very important note you should be aware of is that the crest farming limits were actually reduced. So previously we could get 150 fragments per week, which gave us 15 crests to work with when you combine them. That would be the equivalent of 150 crests in Season 3, but our crest limits are actually being reduced down to 90 per week. So you can only get 90 crests of each type per week in Season 3, giving us significantly less upgrades per week when compared to Season 2. That will slow down the folks who are capping on their crests in Season 2, but for anyone who isn't going hard right at the start of the season, it probably won't make too much of a difference, but it is definitely something you should be aware of. One good piece of news here though is that if you do cap on crests for a week, completing the same kind of content will automatically reward you with the next tier down of crests. So if you're farming worm crests, for example, and you cap out on worm crests, doing content that would reward more worm crests will instead reward you with drake crests. This means that you don't have to start trying to target different rewards after you cap out on certain crests. The game will shift the rewards around for you, so you can just focus on running the content that you're interested in, instead of trying to min-max the crest rewards after you cap out for the week. So that is a great quality of life addition as well. That's not the only gear upgrade changes we have in Season 3 though. There are also some new requirements when it comes to getting higher item level gear crafted. Season 3 will introduce a new crafting spark, the Spark of Dreams, which we will collect in the same way as the Season 2 sparks. We will need two splintered sparks to combine into one whole spark, but this time there's another cost associated with this process. You will need to spend 250 flight stones every time you want to combine a spark, which means flight stones will be a bit more important for anyone who relies on crafted gear to gear up. Another big change for Season 3 and gearing in general is that the Revival Catalyst will be opening up way earlier in this next season. So instead of waiting 6 weeks to be able to target your tier set pieces, the Catalyst will actually be available in week 1, meaning we can immediately start converting seasonal gear into tier set pieces as long as you have a charge available. We'll get one charge in the first week of the season and then one charge every 2 weeks after that. So not only will we have access to our first quick piece of tier gear much earlier, but the timeline of charges also gives us our full 4 set bonus earlier than previous seasons as well, assuming you're relying on the Catalyst as your only source of tier gear anyway. If you get some tier pieces from other sources like the raid or your weekly vault, you'll have your 4 set even sooner. So getting tier gear should be a breeze in the new season. Now, one important class change that might have gone under the radar is that we have a new raid buff coming in patch 10.2. Hunters will be able to provide another damage bonus via their Hunter's Mark, which increases all damage a target takes by 5% while above 80% health. This will make the first section of any boss fight a bit easier and faster, and could be very important for nuking down priority adds, especially if they have a lot of health. So hunters are going to be a bit more useful in the next season, just something to think about when you're looking at which classes you want to invite to your next raid. Something else that could be very important for you to know as we head into the new season is that several trinkets are getting nerfed quite badly. Rashok's Molten Heart is having its mana restore reduced by 70%, healing reduced by 50%, and versatility reduced by 20%, so that trinket is getting nerfed into the ground. Beacon to the Beyond had its damage reduced by 11%, the ominous Chromatic Essence secondary stat granted is being reduced by 5%, and then the Hunter, Shaman, Warlock, and Monk class trinket from Neltharion will have its duration doubled, but the primary stat value is getting slashed in half. So if you have one of these trinkets right now, you'll want to replace it as quickly as you can when the new season starts. Patch 10.2 also brings us some new dragon riding updates to play around with. There are new glyphs in the Emerald Dream Zone, new mounts and customizations to collect, but the important thing I wanted to highlight in this video are the new talents. There are 3 new talents coming that offer even more ways to generate vigor and stay airborne as long as possible. Second Wind lets you generate vigor on demand, and Swift Skimming lets you benefit from ground skimming even at high speeds. Now the real tip here is that you can freely swap your dragon riding talents around, so when the patch launches I would take points out of things like Airborne Recovery and Aerial Halt and put them into Second Wind and Swift Skimming. That will give you access to the most vigor generation available so you can zoom around the new zone even faster. After you pick up the new Emerald Dream glyphs, you can then fill out the rest of the dragon riding talents. We're also going to have a new round of War Mode gear to collect, which means a new set of transmog, but War Mode or Open World PvP gear has always been a very accessible way to gear up in Dragonflight. For patch 10.2 and Season 3, the gear will be item level 431, which isn't all that high in the grand scheme of things, but with the gear only costing you a few hundred bloody tokens each, it's quick and easy to get your hands on this stuff, which makes it a great way to quickly gear up new characters or alts to help them get into some of the harder types of content. We'll also see an interesting change to Trophies of Strife, the item that allows you to upgrade this gear. The trophies will still be available from the weekly quest, but you'll be able to straight up buy trophies for a good chunk of honor. So if you end up with a large surplus of honor at some point, you could use it to upgrade this War Mode gear if you don't have anything else you want to spend it on. Moving on, a pretty important profession update could change how valuable or powerful crafted gear ends up being in the new season. A lot of the most popular embellishments have been nerfed quite considerably. This includes the Frostfire Belt, Fang Adornments, Slimy Expulsion Boots, Toxic Thorn Foot Wraps, Acidic Hailstone Treads, Magazine of Healing Darts, Playful Spirits First Set, Shadow Flame Tempered Armor Patch, Spore Colony Shoulder Guards, and the Amis of the Blue. They're all getting nerfed by 35%, with the Amis getting nerfed by 30%, so they just won't be as powerful next patch, which you will want to keep in mind when getting some items crafted. Another important profession change in 10.2 is a new healing potion recipe. We don't have too many new recipes to collect and use in the new patch, which is a bit of a shame, but the new healing potion is definitely something to keep in mind. The Dreamwalker's healing potion will restore about the same health as a refreshing healing potion, but then it will also restore that same amount again over 6 seconds, so it's almost like getting a second healing potion for free, and it heals over time, which means these potions will be very useful for high ticking damage scenarios. If you're curious, there is another new potion coming, the Potion of Withering Dreams. This one heals for an insane amount up front, but then deals a large amount of damage over time. Potentially useful in some very niche scenarios, but I would definitely stock up on the Dreamwalker potions if you're heading into any difficult content in 10.2. Now, something else you'll want to know about, especially if you are behind on renown or reputation in Dragonflight, is that we'll have a new catch-up option coming in 10.2. You'll be able to spend flight stones on reputation tokens with any faction introduced before 10.2, so that includes the Valdrakken Accord, Iskara Tuskar, Marowak Centaur, Dragonscale Expedition, and even the Loam Niffen. They are a little expensive, 150 flight stones for 50 reputation at a time, so they're more like a flight stone dump than anything else. But if you do a lot of dungeons and want the renown rewards without actually having to farm the reputation directly, this is definitely something you'll want to keep in mind. Now, an interesting update is a brand new Pathfinder achievement. Usually these achievements allowed us to fly in any new zone introduced in a new patch, but dragon riding kinda takes care of that. So this time, the Pathfinder achievement is actually kinda the opposite. It will allow us to use old flying mounts and the old flying style in the Dragon Isles instead. So if you want to use the older, more controlled, slower form of flying for whatever reason, you know, maybe to collect treasures, or to go straight upwards without having to worry about vigor, or maybe you just don't like dragon riding that much. Whatever it is, you'll be able to use your old style flying mounts in the Dragon Isles if you can complete this achievement. Something else you might want to keep your eye out for relating to reputation is a new permanent augment rune coming in the new patch. It will take a little bit of effort and a lot of gold to get your hands on, but if you get up to renown 18 with new faction coming in the Emerald Dream Zone, you'll be able to purchase this new infinite augment rune from the Dream Wardens for 100,000 gold. If you use a lot of runes, and runes are expensive on your server, this could save you a lot of gold in the long run, but it will take a little while to actually get there. I'm not sure how quickly we can farm rep with the new faction, but Renown 18 is gonna take some elbow grease no matter what. It could definitely be worth it if you raid or do high-end Mythic Plus dungeons a lot, though. And then on a lighter note, there are some nice accessibility and customization options coming in 10.2 as well. One new addition I want to highlight is the ability to change how the quest panel and text looks when you're picking up or handing in your quests. We have a few different preset options to choose from. Default is going to keep things how they usually are, but then we have Light 1, Light 2, and Light 3, which will all change the background of the quest panel while keeping the text black. And then we also have a Dark option, which gives you a much darker background with white text. Personally, I'll be swapping this over to the dark mode as soon as 10.2 launches, and probably never changing it back. Dark mode has been huge for applications and browsing, so adding it in for WoW quests just makes sense. But that rounds out our list of smaller things coming in 10.2. As you can see, there is a lot more coming in this patch than just new raid content and a new zone. Sometimes the smaller changes, especially the ones that you might not know about, or the ones that get lost in the noise, can be some of the most impactful in a new patch. Or at the very least, they're still very nice to know about. So that's our list of 19 small changes we think you absolutely need to go about heading into this patch. Is there anything else coming in the patch that you think should be on this list that we didn't include? And what are you most looking forward to in patch 10.2? Leave all your thoughts in the comment section below. A big thank you to all of our supporters over on Patreon and to all our members who are on YouTube. You can see their names floating by on screen. If you'd like to add your name to the end of every video with a special shout out at the start of the next video, you can find links in the description over to Patreon or click the join button just below this video. And if you want to see more videos like this, make sure to subscribe and ring that notification bell so you never miss another video. Thanks for watching, folks. Good luck and have fun. And as always, I will see you next time.